So in the last class, we have discussed about the prefix code as an efficient one to transmit the information from the transmitter side to the receiver side. And while discussing the prefix code, we have already identified that there is one property associated with the prefix code. The property is that if I consider the different code words pertaining to the different symbols within the alphabet, then the code word for any particular alphabet or any particular symbol cannot be the prefix of some other code word. So that was the fundamental idea behind this prefix code. Now today I'll be discussing about two important types of source encoding algorithm. Now to start with, let me consider the first source coding algorithm, which is known as Huffman coding. Now, in case of Huffman coding, what is done? Let me first write down the step so that you can understand. So the step one is, for Huffman coding, you do have a number of symbols in any particular alphabet. And apart from that, the corresponding probabilities of appearance or probability of occurrence of each of the symbols is also given. So that means this Huffman coding is based on a probabilistic model of the source statistics. So in the first step, what is done? You need to arrange those different symbols in accordance with their probability in descending order. So first step or step one is arranging the source symbols according to probability in decreasing order. So that is the first step that you need to do in case of Huffman coding. So if you have, say, k number of such source symbols, S1, S2, up to Sk, and for each of the source symbols, the corresponding probability occurrence is also given. And from your knowledge on information theory, you know that the probability occurrence is inversely proportional to the information content within a particular symbol. So that means we are arranging those source symbols in a descending order as far as the probability is concerned. Or in other words, you can say that you are arranging the source symbols in terms of their information content in ascending order. Both of these two statements will give you the same meaning. Then in the next step, or step two, you need to consider the two symbols from the bottom of the list, which are having the minimum probability. And you need to assign arbitrarily the symbol 0 and 1 to each of them. So in step two, you have to pick up two symbols from the bottom of the list. Obviously, since you are picking up the symbols from the bottom of the list, so you are picking up the symbols with the minimum probability or the symbols with the maximum information content. And you need to assign zero and one to them. So you have to identify two different symbols from the bottom of the list. The list which I have already prepared in the step number one. So from the bottom of the list, you will identify two symbols which are having the minimum probability, or in other words, which contain the maximum information. And arbitrarily, you have to assign the bit 0 and 1. Now, while you are making this assignment 0 and 1, in a particular code word, that arbitrariness should be followed. So I'm coming to that. What do you mean by this arbitrariness on all? And this particular condition or this particular step is known as the splitting phase or splitting state. Then in the third step, you have to combine these two symbols together and the corresponding probability of the combined symbol is nothing but the summation of the individual probability. And you need to put the symbol in the next stage in the list corresponding to the cumulative probability. So in step three, you have to combine those two symbols, combining those two symbols with a probability equal to the sum of the two individual probabilities. So you have started with two different symbols in step number two from the bottom of the list. And in step number three, you have to combine those two symbols with a total probability equal to the sum of the two individual probabilities. And accordingly, you have to place the combined symbol in the list on the basis of combined probability or total probability. And step four is nothing but you have to repeat the process. You have to repeat the step number two and step number three until and unless you are left with only two symbols. So initially, we may be having say 10 number of symbols. Now you have to start from step number one by arranging those 10 symbols in the order of descending probability. So the symbol with highest probability will be at the top, then the next, and so on. And ultimately, the symbol which will be there at the bottom of the list will be having the least probability or the minimum probability. And in step number two, we have to pick those two symbols which are having the minimum probability, and we have to arbitrarily assign the bit 0 and 1 to them. And the arbitrariness should be followed throughout the entire algorithm. And in step number three, you have to combine those two symbols, or I should use a term over here, those two symbols from the bottom of the list and the combined symbol will be having a probability which is nothing but the sum of the two individual probabilities. And accordingly, you have to place the combined symbol in the list on the basis of the combined probability or total probability. And in step four, you have to repeat the process. You have to repeat step number two and step number three. Repeat step two and three. Step two and step three. Unless there are only two symbols. As you can understand, by virtue of step number three, you are combining two symbols and you are observing the two symbols as a single symbol. That means initially in the particular list, if you have k number of symbols, then if you follow step number two and step number three, particularly if you follow step number three, then the total number of symbols in the list will become k minus one, because the symbols with the minimum probability will be combined together and they will be treated as a single symbol. So those two symbols will be combined into a single symbol. So if you have k number of symbols in the list, then after passing through step number three, the total number of symbols in the list will become k minus one. And then once again, if you follow step number three, then it will become k minus two and so on. So accordingly, in step number four, you have to repeat this step two and step three unless there are only two symbols left. And step five is all about tracking the symbols backward so as to assign the code word corresponding to each of the symbols. So this is all about the five different steps pertaining to Huffman coding algorithm. Now it will be easier for you if I give you an example. Now to start with, let us consider in the source alphabet, we have say five symbols. So let us consider we have five symbols in the alphabet. Like we have S0, S1, S2, S3, and S4. And obviously the corresponding probabilities are given by, say, let it be say, S0 is having a probability of 0.4, S1 having a probability of say 0.2, S2 having a probability of say 0.2, so 0.4, 0.2, 0.2, that is 0.8, and let S3 is having a probability of 0.1, and S4 is having a probability of 0.1. So I have five symbols like S0, S1, S2, S3, and S4, and suppose the symbols are ordered in such a way that their probabilities are arranged in the descending order. So S0 will be at the top, then S1, followed by S2, S3, and ultimately S4. Now we have to identify the different stages pertaining to let it be say stage one. So we require fuser stage. Let it be stage two. And let it be stage three. So if I consider the different steps pertaining to the Huffman coding algorithm, so already the step one is over because we have arranged the source symbols according to the probability in descending order. This has been done. Now in step two, we have to pick up the two symbols from the bottom of the list, and we need to assign the bit 0 and 1. Now S3 and S4, these are the two bits for which the probability is the minimum, that is 0.1 and 0.1. So accordingly, you have to assign the corresponding bit. Suppose this corresponds to 0 and this corresponds to 1. And what will be the total probability? The total probability will become 0.2. Now what you can do is, so S0 will be having a probability of 0.4, so it will directly go to stage one. And here the total probability is 0.2. Now you can place it as high as possible or you can place it as low as possible. Now you can see here 0.1 and 0.1, if you add this to probability, the combined symbol will be having a probability of 0.2. Now already in the list you have two other probabilities, 0.2 and 0.2. So the question is that how to place the combined symbol. So there could have been two different options. So let me explore each of these options separately. Now let us consider in the first option, we are moving or we are placing the combined symbol as high as possible. So after 0.4, we have to place the 0.2 corresponding to the combined symbol. And then we have this 0.2 corresponding to S1 and this 0.2 corresponding to S2. So in fact, the combined symbol S3 and S4 will move over here in the list. Now, once again, in stage number one, as you find, so if I consider this is stage number zero, then in stage number one, we have four symbols because already these two symbols are combined together. Now we have 0.2 and 0.2. What we can do is you can add them together, the corresponding probabilities. And let us assume that this particular symbol corresponds to zero and this particular symbol corresponds to one. So I am following the same convention, zero, then one. Here also zero, then one. So as I mentioned, it can be managed arbitrarily. So either you can place zero over here, one over here, or the vice versa, one over here and zero over here. But the arbitrariness should be followed throughout. So there is no hard and fast rule which one to assign zero and which one to assign one. But if I assign zero as the penultimate one and one as the last one, then you have to follow this one throughout the entire algorithm. So then this 0.2 and 0.4, 0.2 and 0.2 will become 0.4 in the combined list. So it will move over here, 0.4, and then we have the 0.4 and then 0.2. So this combined symbol will be placed in the next stage over here. Then once again, you have now 0.4 and 0.2. Now you can combine them together with this is zero and this is one, and the combined symbol will having a probability of 0.6. So now it will be 0.6 and the 0.4 will be placed over here. And ultimately, we are left with only two symbols, 0.6 and with a probability of 0.6 and 0.4. So I can consider this as zero and this as one. So step one to step four is complete now. Now you have to backtrack those patterns of zeros and one to identify the corresponding code word for each of the symbols. So let us consider that, let me write it down over here. S0, S1, S2, S3, and S4. So these are the five symbols. Now, let us try to understand what will be the corresponding code word pertaining to the symbol S0. Now, S0 initially was having a probability of 0.4. Now you have to track this 0.4. So here in this particular stage, nothing has been assigned to S0. So it moves to the stage number one over here. So as you find, there is no assignment against this number 0.4. And then the 0.4 has been moved over here. The 0.4 has been moved over here. And then ultimately, whenever the 0.4 is combined with the 0.2, it moves to stage number three with an assignment of zero. So if you backtrack symbol S0, you'll find that the first assignment was zero and the second assignment was zero. So if you backtrack, what will be the corresponding probability? It will be zero first and then zero. Zero, then zero. And there is no further assignment. So for S0, the corresponding code word will be nothing but 0, 0. Now let us try to identify the next symbol, that is S1. Now for S1, if you observe over here, so that was having a probability of 0.2. Now this 0.2 is moved to stage 2 over here, because this 0.2 corresponds to the combined symbol S3, S4. And this 0.2 is for S1. So this 0.2 is over here. And now there is an assignment of 0. Then it moves over here. And ultimately, this 0.4 comes over here. So if you backtrack from this particular point, so here is an assignment of 0. And then in stage 2, there is no assignment. And then there's another assignment of 1. So if you backtrack, what will be the corresponding code word? The code word is nothing but 1 and then 0. The first assignment was 0, the next assignment was 1. So if you backtrack, the corresponding code word will become 1 and then 0. So for S1, it will be 10. Now let us consider the next symbol, that is S2. So it was 0.2 over here, and this 0.2 corresponds to this one, the lower one. This upper 0.2 is for S1, and the lower 0.2 is for S2. So here, there was an assignment of 1, and then it moves over here, 0.4, and then this 0.4 comes over here. So if you backtrack, what will be the corresponding assignment? 1, then 1. So the corresponding assignment, corresponding code word, is nothing but 1, 1. Now let us consider the last two, that is S3 and S4. Now for S3, initially there was an assignment of 0. Then the combined symbol moves over here. And then the 0.2 comes over here. And now there is an assignment of 1. So initially there was an assignment of 0. Then there was an assignment of 1. And then ultimately there was an assignment of 0. So initially 0, then 1, and then 0. If you backtrack from this point, it will be 0, then 1, and then 0. It will be 0, 1, 0. It will be better if I identify the corresponding movement. In fact, this 0.4 corresponds to this 0.4, as you understand. This 0.2 is for this 0.2. And then this 0.4 corresponds to this one. And then this S1 is corresponding to this one. So blue dashed line signifies there is no assignment in the previous stage. And ultimately, we have to identify the last symbol, that is S4. So for S4, initially we have the assignment of 1. Then it moves over here, then 1, and then ultimately 0. So 1, 1, 0. So if you backtrack, it will be 0, 1, 1. So for S4, it will be 0, 1, 1. So now if you just take a look at those 5 different code words, for S0, it will be 0, 0, S1, 1, 0, S2, 1, 1, S3, 0, 1, 0, and S4, 0, 1, 1. You find that it's a perfect example of prefix code, because none of the code words is the prefix to some other code word. If I consider this 1, 1, so this 1, 1 is a code word corresponding to S2, but you never find that this 1, 1 is a prefix to some other code word. 0, 1 is a prefix for S3 and S4, but 0, 1 is not considered as a code word. So therefore, it's a perfect example of a prefix code. Then after getting this code word for each of the symbols, then you have to find out what about the average code word length. So average code word length, as you know, the average code word length can be written like L bar, and this L bar can be represented by summation over See, here k is equal to 1 or k is equal to 0 to 4, pk multiplied with lk. This is the expression for the average code word length. S0 is having a code word length of 2, S1 is having a code word length of 2, and S2 is having a code word length of 2. However, for S3 and S4, the corresponding length of the code words are 3. However, all these 5 symbols do not have a uniform probability. So therefore, in order to find out the average code word length, you have to multiply the code word length with the corresponding probability. So if you do that, what you are getting? So for the first symbol, if you put k is equal to 0, it will be nothing but 2 into 0.4. Then you have 2 into 0.2. Plus you have 2 into 0.2. Plus you have 3 into 0.1. Plus 3 into 0.1. So if you calculate, you find over here, the first value is 0.8. Then we have, let me calculate, 0.4, then another 0.4, then 0.3 plus 0.3. So ultimately, the final result will give you the average code word length of 2.2. So average code word length is equal to 2.2. Now let us have a look whether this average code word length approaches the entropy of the source or not. Because last day, while considering the efficiency of any source coding algorithm, we have mentioned that the efficiency of any source coding algorithm is given by the ratio between the minimum value of this L bar and the actual value of the L bar. That means this eta was given by L min by L bar. And from the Shannon's coding theorem, it was already proved that the minimum value of this L bar could have been equal to the entropy of the source. So therefore, let us try to find out what is the entropy for this particular source. So entropy, as you know, it can be calculated. Entropy of the source symbol or of the source statistics, you can also say, that is equal to H of curly S. So this is nothing but summation k is equal to 0 to 4 pk I of sk. That is equal to k is equal to 0 to 4 pk, and it will be log 2 base 1 upon pk. So let me put the value. It will be initially 0.4 log 2 base 1 upon 0.4. Then the next two values are same, that is 0.2 log 2 base 1 upon 0.2. And this is true for both k is equal to 1 and k is equal to 2. And for the last one, it will be 0.1 log 2 base 1 upon 0.1 multiplied with 2. So I have taken care of all the 5 symbols, 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Now let me calculate what is the value over here I'm getting. So it will be 0.4 log 2 base 1 upon 0.4. So 1 upon 0.4 will give me 2.5. So log 2.5 divided log 2 will give you 1.32. Then you have 1 upon 0.2 means 5. So log 2 base 5 means log 5 by log 2. It will give me 2.32. So 2.32. So into 0.2 into 2.32 into 2, And then the last one, log 2 base 1 upon 0.1. So 1 upon 0.1 is 10. So log 10 upon log 2 will give me 3.32. So 0.1 into 3.32 into 2. So ultimately, what we get is 0.4 into 1.32. Let me calculate. Plus 0.2 into 2.32 into 2 plus 0.1 into 3.32 into 2. So ultimately, it will give you a value of 2.12. The calculation reveals that the entropy of the source is given by 2.12. So now, if I consider the efficiency of such a source coding algorithm for that particular source statistics is given by the efficiency eta, as you know, is given by the L minimum, or rather L bar minimum upon the L bar, which is nothing but the entropy divided by L bar. Now L bar we have already calculated, that was the last slide. We have got like 2.2, and here the value is 2.12. So ultimately it will be 2.12 upon 2.2. So this will give you a value of 96.3%. 96.3%. So this is the efficiency of the source coding algorithm that we are considering. Now, in this particular assignment, what we have done is we have arbitrarily assigned 0 and 1, and we have followed the same arbitrariness throughout. While moving the combined symbol to the next stage, we have made an assumption that the combined symbol is moved as high as possible. Now, let us check whether the result is valid or not if I make a different kind of assignment. That means the combined symbol is moved to as low as possible. So let me do the same thing for the same source statistics. So let me write it down very quickly. So we have S0, S1, S2, S3, S4. The corresponding probability 0.4, 0.2, 0.2, 0.1, 0.1. So these are nothing but the symbols. And these are the probabilities. And let us consider this is stage 1. This one is stage 2. And let this be stage 3. And as we have only 5 symbols, so after stage 3, we have only 2 symbols. So now this 0.1 and 0.1 will become 0.2. And now this 0.2 will be placed over here as low as possible. 0.2, 0.2, and 0.4, like this. Let me first write down the probability. 0.4, 0.4, 0.2, and then we have 0.6, 0.4. And then let me do the assignment. So let this be 0, let this be 1, and the combined symbol is moved over here as low as possible. Then we have these two, 0 and 1, and the combined symbol is moved over here, 0.4. And as you can understand over here, it will be 0, it will be 1, and the combined symbol is moved over here. And this corresponds to 0, this corresponds to 1 finally. And let me also identify the corresponding movement so that you can backtrack the corresponding code words. This 0.4 in the stage 1 is mapped over here, and 0.2 is mapped over here, and this 0.4 is mapped over here. So if I start from the first symbol, that is S0, So for S0, 0.4, if you backtrack, what is the corresponding value? That is only 1. So 1 is the code word corresponding to S0. For S1, you need to identify S1. So as you find over here, this 0 and this 1. And then you can identify what is the corresponding code word for S1. For S1, if you just follow this path, there is no assignment over here. There is an assignment of 1, and then there is an assignment of 0. So if you backtrack, it will be 0 and 1. So for S1, it will be 0 and 1. For S2, you have to identify. So 0 here, then 0 here, and then 0 here. 0, then 0, and then another 0. So for S2, it will be 0, 0, and 0. Now let us check for S3. So for S3, if you follow, you'll follow this path. So 0 first, then 0, then we have 1, then we have 0. So 0, 0, 1, 0. So 0, 0, 1, 0. This will be for S3. Let us check once again. S3 is from this point, this particular probability. If you follow this particular path, you'll see that the last assignment was 0. So you have to start from 0. Then we have another 0. And then we have 1 over here, and then 0. And similarly for S4, only the last digit will be changed. It will be 0, 0, 1, 1. So for S0, it will be having a code word of 1. For S1, it will be 01. For S2, it will be all 030. For S3, it will be 0010. And for S4, it will be 0011. So now here, if you want to find out the corresponding average code word length, so average code word length L bar is given by 0.4 into 1. Then you have 0.2 into 2 corresponding to the symbol S1. And then you have 0.2 into 3 corresponding to S2. And for S3 and S4, you have 0.1 into 4 into 2. So if I calculate, what you're getting is 0.4 plus another 0.4 plus 0.6 and plus 0.8. It will give you 2.2. So there is no change in the average code word length. Previously also, we have got an average code word length of 2.2. This time also, we have got an average code word length of 2.2. So as far as efficiency is concerned, so you'll be having the same efficiency of 96.3%, because the H of S, that is the entropy of the source statistics, is also fixed and it depends upon the probability of the individual symbols. So it doesn't matter whether you place the combined symbol up or down, whether you place the combined symbol as high as possible or as low as possible. The individual code words are different. As you can find, in the first assignment, S0 was having a probability of 0.4, and it was having a code word of 00. But this time, S0 is having a code word of 1 only. So the individual assignments are different. But however, as far as the average code word length is concerned, so it will be fixed, and it is equal to 2.2 for this particular case. Now, this is all about the Huffman coding algorithm. And over many years, this Huffman coding algorithm was considered to be unchallenging, and it was very efficient source coding algorithm to be used widely. However, as you can understand, this source coding, this particular source coding algorithm, that means the Huffman coding algorithm, is having a serious disadvantage in the sense that you have to identify the corresponding prior probabilities. Because until and unless you know the individual probabilities for each of the symbols, that means here we have worked with only 5 symbols, so you need to know what are the corresponding probabilities. And if you do not know anything about this probability, then you cannot proceed with the Huffman coding algorithm. So in order to ensure that the Huffman coding algorithm will work properly, so this prior probability has to be known. Otherwise, you cannot proceed further. And the situation will be even difficult if I do not consider the symbols as a single alphabet like this. If I consider an English literature, in which case, not only the individual alphabet, but also the corresponding words or phrases are treated together. Last day I was telling that the condition of having a maximum length, maximum code word length for the symbols which is having the maximum information content is also followed in Morse code. In Morse code, it was initially applied to the alphanumeric characters, and if I consider the different alphabets in English literature, then you'll find that E is having the maximum probability, the highest probability, and Q is having the lowest probability. So in Morse code, the E was represented by a single dot. And however, Q was represented by like dash, dash, dot, and dash. So it was having a code word length of 4, which is having the minimum probability or maximum information content. Now that was the scenario for a single alphabet. But if I consider the alphabets together, that means a word, or words together, that means a phase. So in that case, you have to save all the individual probabilities in the database. Otherwise, this Huffman algorithm cannot work. So therefore, if I consider two different words, let me consider the word the, T-H-E, and let me consider another word, say zebra, Z-E-B-R-A. So if I pick these two different words from the English literature, and you understand that the word the occurs frequently. If I consider any paragraph of say 100 words or 200 words, you'll find the probability of the is the maximum, irrespective of the content. Irrespective of the content, irrespective of the material, the will be there always. However, the term, the word zebra, or the term like Q, or any other peculiar term, so they will occur infrequently, rarely. So if I want to incorporate the concept of this Huffman coding to all the words available in the English literature, then I need to store all the information over here. And for English literature, for any type of language, it will be very difficult to implement. So that's why this Huffman coding algorithm is having some serious limitations, because the prior probability is not known always. And even if it is known, it is very difficult to assimilate all the information within a database. So that's why another new source coding algorithm has been proposed, and which is known as a Lempel-Ziv algorithm. So I'll be discussing this one as an improvement over Huffman coding algorithm. So you have to identify, first of all, what are the difficulties, what are the limitations associated with this Huffman coding algorithm. The first disadvantage was that in order to operate the source coding algorithm by virtue of Huffman tree, so you need to know all the prior probabilities before the source coding algorithm is applied. That is not at all possible always. And the second limitation is in the form of storing all the information within the database. So to get rid of this, this Lempel-Ziv algorithm has been used. So let me first I think it will be better if I start with the example directly. Suppose the data stream, let us consider the data stream that I need to encode. It's given by, let the data stream be like this, 0, 0, 1 0 1 1 0 1 0 1 1 0 1 1 1 0 1 1 0 1. And it will continue. So I have just shown a fraction of the data stream which I need to encode. So how many 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17. Okay. 17 such bits are there. 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1. So this is the data stream that I need to encode. Now, before applying this Lempel-Seal algorithm, I have to assume that the two symbols are already there in the code book. So symbols are already there in the code book. These are nothing but 0 and 1. Symbols in code book. Initially, we have started with these two symbols. So 0 and 1. So these are the two symbols which are already there in the code book. Now, based on that, I have to find out the corresponding code word for this particular data stream. So what was the approach? So so obviously you have to start from this point. So this is the beginning. So first 0, then 0, then 1, like this. So you have to identify the shortest subsequence. You have to identify the shortest subsequence which is not there in the code book. So the data to be parsed is nothing but the shortest subsequence which is not present in the code book. So I think it will be better if I once again symbols in the code book. Okay. So fine. And let me once again list this one. Or let me write like subsequences. So the 0 and 1, they are initially treated to be two different subsequences which are already present in the code book. Subsequences. Then I have to identify the corresponding numerical position. So these are the different attributes, numerical position. Then the corresponding numerical representation. I'll explain each of this numerical representation and ultimately the binary code word. So initially, these are the two symbols which are present in the code book, like 0 and 1, and they are known to be two different subsequences. So we start with 0, and then we have another subsequence, that is 1. Then with this knowledge in our mind, let us start with the encoding this particular data stream. So first bit that you'll encounter over here is 0, and you know already that 0 is there in the subsequence in the particular code book. So therefore, 0 will not be treated as a subsequence which has not been encountered before, because 0 has already been encountered in the code book. So the idea is you have to identify the shortest subsequence which was not encountered before. So since 0 was there, then you go for the next one, 0, 0 together. So obviously, as you can see over here, 0, 0 was not present. So the first subsequence, shortest subsequence that you should parts or that you should identify over here is 0, 0. So I should write over here. First one was 0, second one was 1, and then it was 0, 0. Next one is obviously 1, 0, because 1 was already there in the code book. So the next subsequence which was parsed is nothing but 1, 0. So after 0, 0, the next subsequence it will be 1, 0. Now then it will be obviously 1, 1. It will be simply 1, 1. Next one will be 0, 1, because 0, 1 was not there in the particular list. So the next subsequence is 0, 1. Now, once again, you find another 0, 1 is there. So already it has been encountered. It is already there in the list, in the code book. So I cannot take 0, 1 as it is. So I have to go further and I have to consider the 0, 1, 1 together. So since this 0, 1, 1 has not been encountered before, so 0, 1, 1 will be the next subsequence to be stored in the code book. Then you find 0, 1, 1, 1. So, okay, so 0, 1, 1 has already been encountered. So let it be 0, 1, 1, 1 like this. So I may consider this to be the next, that is 0, 1, 1, 1. Then the next value is 0, 1. So as you know, 0, 1 is already there. So to make it complete, so let me add another, because it is never ending. So 0, 1, 0 like this. So since 0, 1 was already there in the code book, so I can consider 0, 1, 0 as the next subsequence. So 0, 1, 0. So altogether there are 18 such bits: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. And these two subsequences, 0 and 1, they were already there in the particular code book. Now I have to identify the corresponding numerical position. So numerical positions are straightforward. So here the numerical position is 1, this position is 2, this is 3, this is 4, this one is 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So the first position is occupied by the subsequence 0, second position is occupied by subsequence 1, and it was there initially. To operate the algorithm, I have to assume this one. Third position is occupied by 0, 0, fourth position is occupied by the subsequence 1, 0, and so on, and it will continue. Then comes the numerical representation. So since I have to identify the code word corresponding to this point onwards, so it will be better if I put a boundary over here, because my actual data stream starts from this point, from 0, 0 onwards. So as you find over here, this 0, 0, so this is obtained by repeating the subsequence 0 twice, by concatenating the subsequence 0 with itself. And what about the corresponding numerical representation then? Then the corresponding numerical representation is given by 1 and 1. Because if I go to this particular point over here, so 1 corresponds to subsequence 0. So 0, 0 stands for 1, 1, the corresponding numerical representation. So this will act as a pointer. Then you have 1, 0. 1, 0 means 2, 1. So this will act as pointer, 2, 1. Then you have 1, 1. 1, 1 means 2, 2. Then you have 0, 1. 0, 1 means 1, 2. Now you have 0, 1, 1. So remember, this numerical representation is always identified by two position only. So here you have two different segments. One is the root subsequence and the next one is the pointer. Now if I consider 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, so how did you get the 0, 1, 1? Already you have 0, 1 in the code book, and then you have concatenated that particular 1 to get the new subsequence, that is 0, 1, 1. So we have two components within the 0, 1, 1. The first component is for the root subsequence, and the second component is known as the innovation symbol. So 0, 1, so I can identify this one over here. So this 0, 1, this is the root subsequence. and this one is known as innovation symbol. Now, instead of having one, if you have zero over here, you can go to some other subsequence, as was there in numerical position 9. So this is known as innovation symbol. So because of this innovation symbol, you are obtaining different subsequences. For example, the root subsequence was same, that is 0, 1. If the innovation symbol was 1, then you'll be getting this particular subsequence, that is 0, 1, 1. And if the innovation symbol is 0, then you'll be getting this subsequence, which is placed in numerical position 9. So you have to identify the corresponding numerical position, I mean the corresponding numerical representation. So for 0, 1, it will be like 6, and 1, 4, it will be 2. So 6, 2. So the next will be 6, 2. And for this one, as you can understand, 0, 1, 1, it will be like 7, and then 2. And for this one, it will be like 6, and then 1. So once again, if you just take a look at the numerical representation, you will find that there are two different numbers, either 1, 1, 2, 1, 2, 2, 1, 2, 6, 2, 7, 2, 6, 1, like this. However, the last number is either 1 or 2, because this is the innovation symbol, and innovation symbol is either 0 or 1. And this innovation symbol, when it is appended with a root subsequence, will give rise to a different subsequence. So the last symbol in the numerical representation, the last number in the numerical representation is either 1 or 2. However, this number, the first number, can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, anything. Now here, in this particular case, I have considered that suppose there are 9 such positions. So to represent, up to this point, I can also consider. Anyway, I can also consider up to 9 points. So since there are 9 numerical positions, so you have to identify 4 bits are needed. If this symbol is not 0, 1, 0, if it is something other, then I can consider within 8. But in this particular case, since I have used like 9 different numerical positions, so it will be safe to consider 4 bits to represent that particular numerical position. So to start with, let us identify the corresponding binary code word for this particular subsequence. Now here, since it is 1, and 1 corresponds to the subsequence 0, so obviously this value will be 0, and this 1, we have to identify the corresponding binary equivalent of 1. So you know what is the corresponding binary equivalent of 1. So since I have at max 9 different positions, so to be in the safe side, so I can use a 4 bit. So it will be 0, 0, 0, 1, and then another 0. So let me guess that part. Yeah. 0, 0, 0, 1, and then 0. Just like this. 0, 0, 0, 1, and then 0. Or I can do a different thing to save space. What I can do is I can just erase that part. I can erase that part, this last part, so that it can be combined within 8 positions only. It will save space. The idea is the same, right? So let me do this change first. So after that, some other symbols might be there. Now up to this point, if I want to encode the data stream, then for 1, it will be 0, the corresponding innovation symbol is 0, and this 1 can be represented by 0, 0, 1 only. Because now we have 8 numerical positions, so they can be represented by 3 bits only. So it will be corresponding code word will be nothing but 0, 0, 1, then 0. Now you have 2, 1, So 2 is nothing but 0, 1, 0, 0. 2, 2. Now, the last 2 is for the innovation symbol. And here, the corresponding subsequence, which is stored at numerical position 2, is nothing but 1. So therefore, the last bit will become 1. And this 2 is nothing but 0, 1, 0. So ultimately, you have 0, 1, 0, 1. Whatever this 1, 2, the last bit, since it is 2, the last number, since it is 2, and 2 corresponds to subsequence 1. So therefore, the last number will be 1. And this 1 is being represented by 0, 0, 1, 1. Now comes this one, 6, 2. So 2, since the last number is 2 and 2 corresponds to subsequence 1, so the last number will be 1. And 6 is being represented by 1, 1, 0, as you know. 1, 1, 0 is the binary equivalent for 6, so 1, 1, 0, and then 1. And for 7, it will be like 1, 1, 1, and then 1. So this will be the binary code word. And as you can see, for each of the subsequence, even if the subsequences are non-uniform length, because you find here it is of length 2, for 1, 0, having a length of 2, 1, 1, 0, 1. However, 0, 1, 1, the length is 3, and 0, 1, 1, the length is 4. So subsequences are having a non-uniform length, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this. But the corresponding binary code word will be having a uniform length, that is 4 always. Because here, 1 bit is used to represent the innovation symbol, and the rest 3 bit is used to identify the corresponding numerical position. Now, you know that whenever you are getting a code word like this, suppose you have got, so this will be transmitted, this entire thing will be transmitted as the signal being represented by means of the Lempel-Sieve algorithm. This will be transmitted. And you know that 4 consecutive bits will identify a particular subsequence. So this is well known to you, that 4 consecutive bits will correspond to a particular subsequence. So first, let us consider this one, 0010. So this is the binary code word corresponding to the first subsequence. This is the binary code word corresponding to the second subsequence, and so on. So how to get back to the original data stream from this particular binary code word? So you have this binary code word at the receiving end, and from the particular binary code word, you need to identify the data stream originally present in the system. So as you know that the binary code word is divided into, the binary code word is having a length of 4. So you have to initially divide the available data stream into a segment of 4 each. So 0010, 0100, 0101, like this. Now start from this one, 0010. Since the innovation symbol is 0 over here, so you understand that since the innovation symbol is 0, so you understand that in the corresponding subsequence, this will be 0. And then you have 001. So 001 will give you the corresponding pointer. So 001, you have to find out the corresponding decimal equivalent. So 001 stands for 1. So 1, so it will act as a pointer of the subsequence already stored in the code book. So then you go to the numerical position 1. What was there? What was saved inside 1? That is 0. So the subsequence actually transmitted was 00. Then you go to the next block of 4 bits. Once again, you have 0100. So since the last bit is 0, so the innovation symbol is 0. So you can directly identify that the last bit will be 0. Then you have 010. So 010 corresponds to a decimal 2. So you have to search for the numerical position which has been there. So at position number 2, the corresponding subsequence already stored is 1. So it will be 1. Then you consider this one, 0101. So the last bit was 1. So innovation symbol was 1. And actually it is adaptive. Once you are going to decode the individual subsequences from the data stream itself, the code book is being populated. Initially, the code book, we have only 2 symbols, like 0 and 1. And once you get this one, initially you have only 0 and 1 to start with. Initially, you don't have this one. There's 00101101 in the code book at the receiver side. Now to start with, you have got the first subsequence as 0010, the corresponding binary code word. So as you know, 0 stands for 0 and 001 will give you the corresponding location, the pointer. So the location is 1 because 001 is nothing but a decimal 1. So what is there in 1? That is 0. So 00, fine. Then you consider the next one. Now when you got this one, that particular symbol, like 0010, and it corresponds to a subsequence 00, and the first subsequence will be stored in the next position. So already we have only these two symbols, 0 and 1, stored in numerical position 1 and 2 inside the code book at the receiver end. Once you get this 00, once you receive this 00, then you update the subsequence which is present at the numerical position 3. So you put the subsequence 00 at the numerical position 3. So this is updated. Then here you get 10. So then you populate this as 10 like this. And accordingly, that can be restored back. So it will be better if I give you some different example. So let me start with a different code word altogether. So let it be. Let me consider a different combination altogether. Say 0011. Then we have like say 0110. Then we have say 1001. Then you have say 1000. Then suppose 0010. And let us consider another one. It is 4, 4, 8, 12, 16, 20. Let me consider another one. Let it be say 1011. Suppose this is the code word, received code word, which you have got, and in your code book, you have these two symbols only, 0 and 1, and the corresponding numerical positions are 1 and 2 respectively. Rest are vacant, position 3, position 4, position 5. I think I should give more space over here so that the subsequences can be accommodated. So let it be say 3, 4, 5 and so on. So this is 3, say 4, 5, 6, 7. So initially they are vacant. So you have got like 0011. So as you can identify, the 001 is the corresponding pointer, and it will point to the numerical position 1, because 001 is the binary equivalent of 1. The corresponding decimal equivalent is 1. So at position 1, what was stored? The symbol that was stored is 0. So the corresponding subsequence which can be retrieved from this is nothing but 0, and the next one will be 1 because the innovation symbol is 1. So in position number 3, you should update it with 01. Then you consider the next one, 0110. So as you know, this 0 is the innovation symbol, so you put it directly over here. This is the innovation symbol, and 011 corresponds to the corresponding pointer, and 011 is having a decimal equivalent of 3. So it will be having a decimal equivalent of 3. Now, what was there in position number 3? That is 01. At position number 3, you have 01 already stored. So the corresponding bit stream which has been retrieved is nothing but 010. So you have to populate this position like 010. Then you consider the next 4 bits. So here the innovation symbol is 1. And then you have 100. So 100 stands for 4 in decimal equivalent. So 4. So this will give you the corresponding pointer. So what was there in 4? 010. So 0101. And accordingly, you have to populate 0101 like this. Then you have 1000. So obviously, the innovation symbol is 0. And then you have 100 as the pointer to the root subsequence. So 100 stands for 4. So what was there in 4? We have 010. So 010 and this 0. And it will be stored in position number 6, 0100. So the code book in the receiver side is also getting updated. Then you consider this one. Innovation symbol is 0. And then you have 001, and 001 corresponds to position number 1, numerical position 1. And what was there in position number 1? We have 0. So therefore, it will be 00. So now 00 will be placed over here. Look, 00 was not encountered before. If I just consider this particular entry, which I have written with this green color, the 01 on all this, this is the data which was encoded at the transmitter site. So you have 0 and 1 in the code book, so that is fine. Then 01 is the first shortest subsequence which was not encountered before, and the next shortest subsequence was 010, next one was 0101, next one was 0100, and then you have got like 00, because 00 was not encountered before. So in this way, the code book in the receiver side is also getting updated, and we can retrieve the data, the actual data from the code words. Now, in fact, this particular algorithm, this Lempel's algorithm, doesn't require any knowledge about the probability, and which is the biggest advantage over the Huffman coding algorithm. As you know, that for Huffman coding, we need to know the corresponding probability. And this is the biggest advantage for Lempel's. We don't require any probability to know to operate the algorithm. And as far as efficiency is concerned, if this is applied over the English literature, then English text, it was found that the corresponding efficiency obtained with this Lempel's algorithm was almost close to 55% as compared to 43% efficiency as obtained with Huffman coding, because this improvement in efficiency is observed in case of Lempel's algorithm because of the fact that the Lempel's algorithm can identify the inter-character redundancies. If I have two different words, like if I have two different code words like this, say 0101 and 0100. So as you find that between these two code words, there has been a lot of similarity. 0101 and 0100. So the first three words being the same. So the root subsequence being the same. both for 0101 and 0100. The root subsequence being the same, but there is a change in the innovation symbol. And that's why you do have two different code words for each of these. Now, this inter-character redundancies was identified by Lempel-Sieve algorithm, and which was not possible by means of Huffman coding algorithm. So that's why the Huffman coding algorithm lacks as far as efficiency is concerned. And almost if I consider a English text, then the corresponding improvement is almost more than 10% for a Lempel-Sieve algorithm. So these are the two efficient and popularly employed source coding algorithm as far as the digital communication system is concerned. Now, with this, I would like to conclude the discussion on the information theory and source coding.